crown Glenn in Barcelona. Corin in London. And Wynn in Baden. Who will triumph in Dublin in the fourth leg of season 3 of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour? Once again, the Emerald Isle and its capital Dublin has proved a first-class host to Europe's premier poker tournament. The Regency Hotel has welcomed the cream of the poker crop through its doors. Now, for the last 3 days, the hotel has been the centre of the European poker world as 389 players came, chipped up the cash and created a whopping €1.8 million prize pool. Today's champ will get €554,300. And after 3 days of high drama here in Dublin, we're down to the final table. For the 8 remaining competitors, it's time to face their fate. They can invoke the luck of the Irish, the rub of the green, the win of the poker gods, but at the end of the day, it's the cards that will separate the contenders from the pretenders and determine who leaves Dublin with a smile as wide as the Irish Sea and a cheque to match.
Here in Dublin, Ireland.
Well, here we go. There's 8 players at this final table, and what a fighter in seat 1 from England, Rob Young. He's been short-stacked about 15 times up until today. He'll show no fear whatsoever. And when you talk about no fear, let's take a look at the man from Sweden, William Thorsson. Hates to get beat in any hands. A real character. We reckon the baby-faced assassin. Second biggest chip stack at the moment. Now, Ireland is represented at the final table by just one man. His name is George McKeever. He's a businessman from Northern Ireland, and he's here to do the business today. Very short stack, though, 7th at the table. Well, here we go. Patrick Bueno, he's been here before in the EPT Over 3 series. He's from France. He's the shortest stack.
My name is Patrick Bueno. I'm 40 years old. I'm French from Paris. My wife, Patricia, and 3 children, Benjamin and Lara and Fiona. Poker is not my job. It's just my passion. Sometimes I'm not so much aggressive, perhaps. I need more aggressive. I know I can win, sure.
Chip in a chair, 8th smallest stack. Welcome, and beside him Gavin is the third Sims. Biggest, Gavin Dr. Logic Sims, making his first splash on the public level, but a great private player in and around the clubs of London. And he'll be looking to take the chips of Englishman Nick Slade, who again has had a fairly up and down tournament. But it's all good when you make the final table at the EPT. Our chip leader, Roland DeWolf, plays fast, plays loose, plays aggressive. A joy to watch.
Roland DeWolf, age 27, from London, UK. I started playing at the beginning of 2004. Yeah, I like travelling, and poker gives you the opportunity to do that, going to earlier places around the world. So, yeah, I have a great life. I made a final at the World Series of Poker this year. If you win, you always remember it fondly, and if I end up going out first, then, you know, it won't be such a big deal. And to make the final 8 out of 400 odd is really pleasing. I've actually played against everyone on the table before. I don't know, they're all rubbish. I don't really care. Anyway.
And in seat number 8.
Excellent stuff. He's our chip leader at the moment. David Tavernier from France makes up our final table. He's a Poker Stars online qualifier. We've seen a lot of him already here in Dublin. It is very exciting. Anyone can win it. I couldn't be more excited than if it was John Duthie at a Girls Aloud gig. John and I calling the action. As always, with a final table, an exciting day of poker ahead. And, you know, OK, Roland DeWolf has got about a third of all the chips, and we don't often see such a big chip leader. But with the small stacks, they've got nothing to lose.
No, nothing to lose. Well, in effect, it's not strictly true. They've got a lot to lose because the jump in prize money is quite significant. They'll be quite careful and quite particular about the hands they play and the situations they find themselves in. But you're right about Roland. He'll try to dominate the table for sure.
Okay, and some small stacks will be looking at, oh, if I could just get 7th or 6th, it's a big jump up. Other stacks will say, small stacks will say, I want to win this. I'm going for a double up, a triple up, a quadruple up.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that some people will gamble. It all depends on the personality of the player. That's what it comes down to. And the experience as well.
That's the key word, personality, and there's plenty of it at our final table. It's always unpredictable. You see the first hand being dealt out. at final table. What we do know is it doesn't always work where the big stack wins and the eighth stack comes eighth. Expect surprises, because they're always just around the corner in the EPT final tables. It's not just poker anymore. It's nerves. It's guile. It's having the heart and the head for the big occasion. George McKeever folds. Patrick Bueno needs action, and he's not going to get it in this hand. Gavin Sims folds out. Here's our chip leader, Roland De Wolf. Suited connectors. Now, we saw as it got towards the bubble, Roland De Wolf really play fast and loose. John, do you think his approach at the final table will be any different as chip leader?
No, I think he'll. I think he's got enough chips to be able to call the raise of this size, his 9, 10 of spades. He may calm down a little bit.
He'd need to. Okay.
He changes gears a lot, Roland.
A7 suited for David Tavernier. He's French, so we should probably call him David Tavernier, but we'll stick to David. Three players involved.
I don't think he should have called there. I think he should have probably raised.
Let's see. It's all about the red and the black, isn't it? Let's see where the flop comes down. The hand will be defined by the flop, and it's thrown up two diamonds. It's made any flush draws for De Wolf and Thorsen redundant. Inside straight draw for Thorsen. Top pair for De Wolf. This could pay for Tavernier. Wonderful, wonderful start. This is what we're talking about, John.
It's going to be interesting to see. I don't think William announces three. Oh, wow, William's trying to represent an overpair here.
If you want a quiet night, there's probably a gardening programme on the other side. Turn over now, you're not going to get it here.
Wait.
Tavernier overexcited there. Was going to make his move.
It looked like he's about to move all in.
Now that should be enough for Roland De Wolf to say thank you, good night.
Yeah, well that's made his mind up for him.
He's folded top pair as well. Most amateur players wouldn't. Tavernier's moved all in. We could be losing a player early on here.
He's folded. He's folded because there's nothing he can call with. He was bluffing anyway, you see.
I was getting overexcited, wasn't I?
A little bit.
Is it like having another child doing commentary with me?
I think I could see that you wanted that to happen then. You wanted it to happen. But William Thorsen was trying to represent an overpair and got caught out, really.
Why Thorsen's such a good player. He knows when to hold him, knows when to fold him. The old cliche, and he's still in second place. De Wolf's still in the lead. Tavernier is the big mover early on. George McKeever, Patrick Bueno. They need to get busy, John. They need to get busy soon.
No, they certainly do. It's an interesting first hand because Roland, I think Roland was saved there by Tavernier going all in, because I think Roland would have definitely called with the top pair. King 8 for George McKeever.
A little middle hand for George. He's not interested. Sometimes you need chips, but there's no point being silly about it in positions like that. And you just throw those away. Maybe if he's on the button with the King 8, he'd have pushed every chip he had in. But wrong position, wrong time for him. He can wait a bit longer.
No, and once again, the jumps in prize money are quite significant now that we're 8-handed.
Rob Young then. One of four British players at this final table. Right. Such a strong move on the big blind from Thorsen. He's got the second highest stack. That's a statement of intent. I'm not here to pick up second, third, fourth place, to let my chips dwindle away. He's pushed all in, John.
Well, he's got Rob Young well covered. The other thing is that Rob Young slightly overbet. I think he went about 56,000, which is a sign of weakness. When you're in the small blind, it's a definite sign of weakness. You can use that against me, anybody listening. But and William's got a pair, fair enough going all in.
Now he had to fold because, as we know, King Jack is fool's gold. It's a nice hand to raise with in that position if nobody else has anything.
I think that's the last time I can pass now.
But he knows fine rightly he's even behind if Torsten's sitting with ace-7.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
But Rob won't like that because he's put a lot of his chips into that stack.
Well, the fifth place stack, that's probably pushed Nick Slade slightly ahead of him. But at this stage, you take anyone from Tavernier down in third place. If you want to mess with the Wolf or Torsten, it could cost you your seat or it could make your tournament.
No,
in fact, DeWolf's the only player could go all in against any of these stacks and not be crippled by it. That's what makes it such a good final table. Maybe the best we've had so far on the EPT Series 3. Well, here we go. We're getting a move all in from a short stack. It's Bueno, who started the day in 8th, continues to be in 8th. He's lost a couple of blinds. He's pushing all in. Torsten's definitely going to call him. We could be down to 7. Of course,
yeah,
he does.
He's got a call.
Got a call with the ace jack. Okay, well, you can hear the murmurs of the crowd. What are the cards going to be? We know they don't even know here yet. And Torsten will be happy when he sees Bueno with the king 6. And Patrick's going to be thinking about just what drink do I have left in that mini bar in the hotel? What film's on the pay-per-view? That doesn't help him whatsoever. He's fought, he's dug in, fingernails and everything and tables to stay in this tournament. But it could be one hand too far for Patrick Bueno. Here could be the shock. He's opened up a straight draw for an 8, which helps him. It's the only thing can help him. The 8, the king, it hasn't arrived. The 6 also would have done it. And the ace holds up. Pair of jacks for Torsten. And Patrick Bueno started in last position, finishes 8th, picks up a handsome check, and we're down to 7 in Dublin. Stay tuned. Final table. The sights and sounds of the capital city of Ireland. But the only sight that matters is the cards inside this casino, and the only sound that matters is the clink of the chips. 12,000 in the big blind, 6,000 in the small blind, 32,000 in every pot before we even start. We've had winners in Barcelona, a lady in London, and Baden. We're in Dublin, we go Copenhagen. We go Dortmund. We go Warsaw. The Warsaw Pact. Is that what we're calling that? For the Pact of Cards? And Monte Carlo for the final. I should work in advertising. Yeah. I'm good with things like that.
That is okay.
Brilliant.
Warsaw Pact.
Well done, raised to 30,000.
Roland DeWolf again, playing like he did in the last few hours of yesterday. And Queen 5, he's making a raise. And he's got cards ahead of him here. And cards that he won't like. We're only on the button now. Oh.
You got a big hand, Roland?
Have you got a big hand, Roland? I was going to say no.
No, don't. Put all your chips in there, Rob. You've got me. Now, that's not just the chips in his hand there. He also owns the chips just to the side of him. They're just slightly far away from him. The re-raise is inevitable with pocket tens. Very strong hand. The Wolf is going to be on a major bluff. Now, there's my favourite hand in poker, ace-8, but George McKeever playing a very tight final table, and rightly so, folds the small blind. On the big blind is Gavin Sims.
With a bit of staring out going here, look.
Yeah. You looking at me, punk?
He's not going to call.
We had breakfast together.
It's coming up now.
What?
It's coming up now.
You only had soup.
It's coming down. It's coming down. How much you got behind?
Just set me all in. I got.
Young said, "Don't stop messing around. We might have breakfast together. We're not lovers. Put me all in. I'll double up." He knows.
Sure.
The fold comes in. Young takes the hand.
This is all for show, as you know and I know. It's all for show.
I suppose John Rowland is in a situation where he can throw 30,000 here, 30,000 here, 30,000 somewhere else. He's still going to be massive chip leader, and he only needs to catch somebody out once. He's going to get those chips back, and he's going to take players out.
But he's already folded. Rowland's already folded. He's making him count the chips out, even though he's already folded.
There you go. Well, listen, Natalie has caught up with her 9th place in Dublin and a real EPT favourite. Or Natalie should be with Willie Tan somewhere around this casino. More poker in a second.
What a wind-up.
Morgan and Wise.
Now, there's plenty of us that wish this man was on the final table, but he's not. Willie, we expected you to be there.
I wish I am.
I know, but seeing as you're not, who do you think will go on and win this?
Well, I think it'd be a very, very tough fight between the two young boys there, Roland De Woo and WT. My initials there was playing with him for me. William Torrenson, I think, yeah. Both the kids are bang in form, I think. They are both very aggressive, and I shall be... It'd be a very interesting final between the two. I think you will get a lot of enjoyment watching them play.
Willie, it's great to see you again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
What a character.
Did he say you get a lot of enjoyment watching them play?
That's the biggest lie a poker player ever tell you.
He'd rather be there. So pocket tens for Roland.
And Roland raising to 40...
50,000 in total, the 12,000 big blind, plus another 38. We let you know how much more it's going to cost players. And Tavernier's going to call that with his ace-jack suited, and he'll want this to be heads-up without a doubt. He won't want to see anyone else come into this hand. There's one of the Wolves' tens. He won't know that, but it really helps us.
It's interesting. He kind of slightly overbet his pair of tens here.
On saying that, he doesn't need to hit anything. It's all in Tavernier. He's got to do the business, and he's hit. Oh, he's hit a full house in the flop. This could dent De Wolf slightly, and it could put Tavernier as close as the second place here if he can see this through. Can he make it pay? That's the question.
Only if a 10 comes, I think.
He wants a 10, doesn't he?
Yeah. He needs to see a 10 to get any money out of this. He might bet about 50,000 now, or 150 to make it look like a steal.
Yes. Because we talked about this before. He's just checked the big hand. There's been no bets since pre-flop here. And he's opened up the door for doubt in De Wolf's mind. De Wolf may think that Tavernier is talking through his backside.
I don't think he's going to get it.
He calls it. It's only another 40,000. We know how De Wolf plays. It could have cost him more, but it didn't need to cost him that.
He didn't. I think Roland's called that just to see what he's got.
Okay.
He's got enough chips to be able to call 40,000 to get the information.
Call that with a 7-2, didn't
yeah.
he?
Yeah, literally, just to see what he's got, and so he can get some information on how he's played the hand.
Do you know what though? When someone calls a pre-flop raise, and you make a decision about what they're on, you're putting them on a pocket pair. You're putting them on ace king, ace queen, ace jack, and a flop comes out ace ace jack. How can you not put them in the lead?
It's very, very difficult.
It's very easy to say it's flashy, he's getting a read. But you know what? If that was around an amateur table, I'd accuse the player of being a duffer. If that was in my living room, I'd say, what are you calling for? I've told you what I have.
Yeah, it's true, but
obvious trap check.
But sometimes it's good to get information. You don't want to be outplayed all the time whenever there's a pair of aces on the board.
Yeah.
Oh, who's got these queens?
The ladies. And he needs it, you know. Rolling the wave, struggling and last. Oh no, hold on, he's chip leader.
Yeah. That's tens and queens in consecutive hands.
And on the button as well. And he's made it three times the blind.
Slightly less this time than last time, interesting. Yeah. Oh, he's going to get some action here from
Rob Young. And he's went all in.
Oh, he's going to get called too, yeah.
Well, that's a good hand from the go all in on Rob Young. He started today in fifth position. He's been roughly in fifth position all day. And he's making his move. He has to. He wants to win this. Rob's not here to come fifth.
It's very, very even money at the moment.
Well, he could be seventh. Let's see how the flop comes out. Nothing really to help. We'll not talk about straights yet. There's no point. No flushes available from here on in. It's all about whether Young can hit the king of the ace. And he's hit the king. Now, obviously, that means a 10 for De Wolf would give him a straight. So 10 or queen to save De Wolf. Otherwise, he's getting dented for the first time at the final table. And that's exactly what's happening. And Young knows that puts him in a strong situation now.
No, it's the hand played itself.
He needs a break.
Rob is shaking the hand of his mates in the crowd.
It's good to have a wee bit of support behind you there. So when you won your poker million, John, you were all alone.
Yeah, still am.
Robert Young, I'm from Nottingham in England, and I'm 34 years old.
My weakness is patience. That's why I'm not so strong on tournaments. But my strength would be that I can play pretty fearlessly and I can notice weakness in opponents and take advantage of that. I used to be a recruitment consultant. I used to spend a lot of time interviewing people, meeting a lot of people, and that just helps you look at body language and people's voices, etc. So I'd probably say that's the strongest part of my game.
Analytical. And it's good to know that patience is your problem. You can work on it. It's nothing worse than a poker player who thinks he's got the complete deal. No one does, I think it's fair to say. He's never been the complete poker player. We wouldn't have a game if there was.
There's a few people who think they are.
Exactly. And they haven't made a final table of the EPT yet. Huh? How's that for bitchiness, John Duthie? Anyway. Pocket fours for Young. He said he didn't like to be patient. Torsen calls him. It's Queen Jack. I mean, nothing to talk of yet in this hand. It's not going to be a big mover either way.
Unless, yeah.
With Queen Ace.
He may just call here, Gavin, because he's afraid of the limper.
Yeah. You're exactly right there, John. And when we talk about patience, you will not get a problem in that department with Dr. Logic himself, Gavin Sims. He's the first player I play with regularly who's reached the final table.
Now, is Roland going to raise? Just to, because everybody's limped. Is he trying to think, has somebody limped in with aces or kings? And is my seven deuce good? What's he got? Oh, ace queen. That's fair enough, I suppose.
I don't agree with the raise. I think at very best, Roland's entering a crapshoot here.
Well,
I know you wouldn't agree.
I have enough to make you pass.
You do have enough to make him pass.
470,000. You passed the 470.
If Rob could see the other hands, he'd call. Because he knows that.
It probably is enough to fold the entire table.
Well, Roland's actually only got three outs. Look, he's got all the queens are out. Well, what, two of them.
There's only one left in the pack.
Two aces. He's only got, he would only have three cards. If Rob could see the cards here, he'd call like a shot.
Wow. Best hand folds. Is this where the wolf makes me look really stupid?
Now, what's your friend Gavin going to do here?
He's going to fold it out. He identifies that hand as fool's gold, and Slade pushes all in with Jack 9, the worst hand. And the wolf just straight away calls it.
That is bizarre. It's bizarre. But maybe he wants to gamble. He just wants to have a gamble.
Strange decision for the wolf to raise. Strange decision for Young to fold. Cautious decision for Sims to get out of the hand. And gung-ho decision.
What did they say about it being the last queen and two aces he could hit?
Two pair. Slade's got the one pair, though, so he's got the bottom pair at the moment. Let's have a look at the outs that are available. Just the nine, really. Just the nine's going to do the job.
Unbelievable.
Oh, wow. And we lose Nick Slade. What a bizarre hand.
That was a very, very strange hand.
Well, either way, we've got six left. We've lost a Frenchman, and now we've lost 34-year-old Nick Slade. Not a loser, though. He's decidedly richer than he was this morning. He's got money to spend.
I know you don't have ace-king.
And Roland DeWolf wins back any chips he's thrown away so far at this final table.
Amazing.
The UK's Nick Slade goes out in seventh spot. Not bad for a man who's only played poker for 8 months.
I wouldn't say that. I wanted to win the tournament.
I know you did. I know.
I'm not remotely
did.
Interested in anything other than winning the tournament.
I know, but talk me through what it was like up there on that final table.
I mean, it was fine. I was really comfortable with it. You know, I'd just played on the TV in the EPM at Vienna, so you know, I was quite comfortable with it. I was quite comfortable in my position because Roland was on the left of me with all the chips. Rob limped. William limped. I limped. Rob had moved for 100,000. And all day it looked like he was just stealing the limps. So I had another 220,000 to go over the top of his 100,000. So I just thought I'd push and shake him off the hand. unfortunately, had a hand.
He did have a hand indeed.
I wasn't too uncomfortable when I actually saw the ace queen. You know, it's 40-60. William passed the queen. Gavin passed the ace queen. So he's at the case queen, yeah. One of two aces. But yeah. You know, it's the way it goes. I made the move, and you got to do it to win the tournament.
Ironically, that's probably the best read we've heard of Roland De Wolf. All tournament. He was pushing in on weak hands.
Yeah. And he could well have been pushing in with nine deuce, trying to show off.
Well, given that every time I make a statement about Roland De Wolf making a bad call, he wins about 500,000 chips, I'd like to regress and say, I think Roland De Wolf's the best player in the world. I'm going to call him now, and maybe he'll lose some of those hands. If I use that logic. Never called a player more bad than I have Roland De Wolf.
Well, here we've got De Wolf Thorson. And the Yong comes in to make it a triangle. So three players. Oh, God, he's hitting cards. Look at it. He doesn't seem to be able to miss. Now, William Thorson could get into trouble here if he's not careful.
He's got the top pair, Thorson. You've got me calling him Thorson now. It's Thorson. Chip twos for De Wolf.
Great bet. You see, this is the thing. He's bet 70,000 trying to, you know, and William's going to think this is just a steal. If he can get away from this, it's brilliant, but I don't think he can. Wow. If he hits a 10 now, he's in big trouble.
The Wolves made it so that it's very hard to read anything that he does because some of his decisions are baffling.
Well, now he'll probably think that they could be splitting it. Who knows? Let's see how much of it. This is great. Actually, this is good play by Roland. It looks like 150,000. Yeah. This is good play.
He's putting that into a pot that was already sitting just over 200,000. It would be understandable if Thorson thought all he was trying to do was push him off the hand here.
If he can get away from this, it's a great lay down against Roland.
Thorson's really made great lay downs all week.
No, he has.
So he could easily do that.
There's a history between these two. They play a lot. And they know each other a lot. Oops. He's fallen for it. It's excellent play by Roland here, I'll tell you.
Is there a case there for Thorson to maybe make a small raise and try and get something out of De Wolf and see exactly where he stands rather than
small
just
raise.
Call?
How can you make a small raise against 150,000? Yeah, you've got to make it 300,000.
How much you have?
Oh. More.
It looks like about 550, yeah. Something.
I mean, De Wolf has him well covered.
670.
I was only 100,000 off.
You see,
the producer will probably not mind that too much.
You can look at this flop if you're De Wolf and pretty much say that you've won the hand. I mean, there's going to be no straights and there's going to be no flushes. And you may think at worst, Thorson's hit his ace queen. You know, that's the most you're going to put him on here.
He's bet 350,000. It's just about half what William has. This is a very, very interesting hand. It's a very interesting hand.
He can't call it.
Well, the thing is, he might call it. He might call it, but I don't think he's going to. Very good fold.
Well, we've talked a lot about Roland De Wolf and some of the questionable raises he's made, but the ends justifies the means, and now players are finding it very, very hard to read what De Wolf is up to.
Yeah. I'll take my hat off to Roland there. He came out overbetting those trips. Brilliant hand.
We're back after the break, and then Canavan in the EPT final table.
Welcome back to the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. Now, I am surrounded by gamblers, but at the start of play today, there was one bet that no bookie would take, and that was that this final table would become a poker showdown of truly epic proportions. So put your money away.
After seeing what Natalie's wearing, there's a few other things could get put away there. Right, 16,000 in the big blind now, 8,000 in the small blind. The ante is a bet that is an amount of chips that everyone has to put in, so 2,000 for everyone else. Gives us 36,000, six players left.
That's a lot of money in there now. Every single round of, you know, seven cards now, because we've lost one player, costs you 36,000.
Gavin Sims. Gavin Sims, sorry, John, to interrupt you. This is the first movement we might see from him at the final table, other than when he went for a toilet break recently. 34,000 is his raise. He's got ace queen. It's a good position to do it in. He knows Roland De Wolf's on the button. And look at that! He knows he's unreadable now, De Wolf. And he's made that raise on Jack 10.
This is that's kind of dangerous. He's got a couple of players behind him, but he's got through them, and he knows that Gavin probably won't call with anything apart from kings, queens, jacks.
I disagree, John, because Gavin Sims has hardly made a bet at this final table. He may as well write down on a big banner, "I have something now. I have something, Roland."
But it's not that big a hand. But actually, the thing is, he's moved all in because effectively he's hardly got any chips left anyway. Now Roland will probably have to call. Yeah, he has.
Dr. Logic's all in. De Wolf's going to call it. He's had to call it. And Sims is looking at a double up.
Okay, we have it all in call.
Gavin hosts some of the best home games in London. I suppose one of the downsides is his taste in music. Dido, the Lighthouse Family, stuff like that. But apart from that, yeah, well known in London, good player, and about time he made the step up. He's not here to make up the numbers.
I see your point about Gavin not playing a hand.
So why is De Wolf thinking he's trying to steal his, you know, moving towards stealing the blinds? He hasn't done it yet. Unbelievable!
Oh, no.
Oh, he's one card. Look at the anger.
He's out.
He's ready to punch out if he doesn't hit this river. Roland De Wolf, put your guard up. Oh, you no need to.
He got there.
Everyone's friends at the end of that hand, but De Wolf nearly fluked a whole bag of chips.
That's great. It's just over a half a million pot there for Gavin. It's really given him that could be worth a lot of money to him.
Well, look at that there. The sigh of relief from Gavin Sims. Another Londoner looking to make his name in the EPT.
Roland doesn't look quite so invincible anymore.
Well, I think Roland might argue, hey, I've got all the chips in front of me at the moment, but this is the most open final table I think we've had in the EPT in a long time. Any double up anywhere and it's game on. Six left, just one title. Could be De Wolf's, could be McKeever's. Loving it. Well, it's nice to see Right Said Fred have made a quick guest appearance at the final table. There is no uniform as such, is there, for dealers, John? It's never been a... There's no standard way a dealer should dress, is there a dress code?
There's no polo neck.
No, certainly isn't here in Dublin. Right.
He's back on Roland. I wonder if that's going to slow him down a bit, that last little punch to the midriff.
I'd say no. I'd say a punch is likely to slow him down as much as it is Ricky Hatton. He'll just keep coming forward. Well, we've seen it happen again.
Not with this. Suited, yeah, but not offsuit.
Rob shows 9-5 suited, it passes. Roland wins the pot.
He's using his chip stack to bully this table.
As he should.
Gavin has a small blind, Roland has a big blind.
Okay, well, we'll put him on the big blind now and see what happens. Such an illustrious tournament, this, and well, right on cue, we're going to tell you some of the people who've won the EPT. Alexander Stevich. Shipley, the Swanee, who for me is, he's probably my favourite player in the world, to be honest.
He's great.
Boakin.
Pocket nines here for Torsen.
Schaefer, Perot, Hollink, Bublé, Telcher, Antonius. Some of these players weren't known before they won a European poker tour.
No, you're right.
Gavatin, it's made them. Anderson.
Like your career.
Hi, Mark.
Gavin passes.
Maybe not all of them have been made by the European Poker Tour. Williams, Glenn, Corrin, and Wynn, and one person from this table.
Now he's called with King 3 here. He's going to have to get creative.
I hope Torsen wins the hand. Well, the flop's here. No, that's interesting because De Wolf will fancy that, but Torsen's got the jacks and the nines. Not good for De Wolf.
turn six of hearts. Roland checks.
Checks again. He probably fancies this. He probably thinks he's in the lead here, Roland.
I think William will certainly put a bet in here.
45. William bets 45,000.
And that bet says, call me, please.
Roland doesn't like to call. He likes to raise.
Right on cue, John. Right on cue. So big raise. I can't imagine that Torsten still doesn't fancy it. He's got it.
Has he got a jack? Has he got a jack?
No.
120 more to William.
Good call.
That's what he's thinking.
Let's see what happens, though, on the river. Cue the king. Cue the three.
Oh, I
should just keep my mouth shut.
He's so amazing bad.
Roland shows king three of diamonds.
No, Torsten doesn't like to get beat, but what a comment to make at the table. He's basically just went, hey, chip leader here in the EPT. He's rubbish.
Bet the river.
Oh dear. Now Roland's saying I should have bet the river.
It's like a donk play. Raise when he's behind and check when he's ahead.
I have to agree with Torsten. I have to agree. But DeWolf's the one in pole possession.
Now, Greg Raymer may not have made the final table, but he has found something else to keep him occupied. How's it going?
Well, good here. I just made my small blind raise by this gentleman. Can I take a peek at your chips, sir? Ah, cheers. And I'm going to fold. It's a bad hand.
Hey! But you're enjoying yourself?
Oh, yeah, we're having a good time, and, you know, I have a chance to win a little money in this. I failed to win the €500,000 in the main event, but an extra 20,000 never hurts.
Now, what about those guys behind us?
I'm jealous of, yes.
Who do you think's going to win?
You know, I don't even know who the chip leader is now because I've been focused on my tournament. But
no, good. I'm glad to hear it.
They're all good players, from what I understand. The ones I know are good players. The ones I don't know, I'm told, are good players. So I would say it's probably whoever has the most chips.
That would be reasonable. Yeah, suggestion. Yeah. Now, what about this bit of jewellery? Because I'm sorry, I think this is quite intimidating, don't you?
Definitely.
How do you find playing against Greg Raymer?
Very intimidating. He's a big fella, but his bracelet's even bigger.
Enjoy yourself, guys. Thank you very much.
All right, cheers, Natalie.
Thanks a lot.
Well, certainly, the joviality that we've seen here in Dublin, the Irish spark almost, very happy place to be, is disappearing out the window here at the Regency Hotel, because it's hard to remain happy with bad beats flying about everywhere.
Yeah, Roland got incredibly lucky there.
Again.
William's angry.
Roland makes it 60,000.
Why not, eh, Roland? Why not?
David passes.
Rob Young. Pocket jacks. The flop will come down, by the way. I just want you to know in advance, the flop will come down. Diamond, diamond, diamond. Or 7-7-10.
Make a stand. I know you're folding. All in.
Okay.
Rob announces that he's all in.
Pass. Oh, he didn't show.
Shows a jack of diamonds.
Well done, Rob. Well done, Rob. Enough is enough, surely.
He's just having a bit of fun.
They don't want to take flops against somebody who's so hot.
I think that's a positive EV play, isn't it? That's a positive EV play to do that every time.
Please.
In a cash game, maybe? No.
Well, John, Rob Young saying enough's enough here. I'm going to get a bit hard with this big stack.
Yeah, he's kind of had enough. Roland's raising every second hand. He's really trying to dominate the table here. And Rob, you know, Rob's got a playable hand. He's decided to make a stand. In it goes, and you know, Roland, you know, has to fall.
Okay, well, listen, anytime there's a bully, you need someone to stand up to that bully, and that's what's happening now.
First act, this is our last hand of the round, and this will be taking a dinner break.
The thing with Roland DeWolf is, yes, there's ways to play cards. You play cards that aren't that good at times. Ramfaswani's the king of that. You never know what he's going to call in, but it's usually based partly on position, partly in the players who you're playing. With Roland, it seems to be let's throw the chips in, let's spin the wheel, and see what happens. It's exciting. I'll give him that.
I think the trouble is he gets away with it a lot against bad players. But you don't get away with it against someone like William Sawson.
Well, George McKeever hasn't hit a card yet, and he's just been given the worst pocket hand in poker, so that's gone. Oh, De Wolf moves all in. And Young calls him, of course.
How much do you think? Do you think a jack might come here?
I would. Let me think. Where's the keys to my house and my car? I think I'll bet them. Well, listen, De Wolf's not in a good situation here. The ace comes out. That is even better for Rob Young. He said, no more chatting. I'm taking you on, and that's exactly what he's done, and he's done it well. And just one card left for De Wolf. Maybe this is one bad call too many for Roland. They say he's a wolf in sheep's clothing. Oh, no! Right, I'm leaving. Goodbye, everyone. I've had enough. No more commentating for me. I can't take it. Bye!
He actually has gone. That's incredible. That's so bad for Rob. So, look at his face. It's unbelievably bad.
It's a fair city, but poker is not a fair sport. And everything is going on at our final table here on the EPT in Dublin. Money being counted out for Rob Young. €88,690, but no smile on his face. A lot of money. But after the beat he's just taken, he'll feel slightly aggrieved. It's a weird thing. You can go out, sort of with €7,000 and think, you know what, I got away with a bit today and I'm quite happy with that and I'll have a drink with my mate. Rob Young walks away with 88,000 over. And he'll feel like it should have been so much more.
He will not feel good.
At last, a card for the last Irish representative at this table from Northern Ireland, George McKeever. And it's king-queen. And he's put roughly $250,000 chips in. Let me just think. Do you think De Wolf will call him? Has he got anything over a 7?
He's probably got 7, 8, 10 jack, ace 7. Who knows? He could have anything.
I think to make it unpredictable and sometimes bet small hands is an asset. Ramfaswani does it well. Roland De Wolf's just been calling anything. And I don't think that is an asset. I don't think that is good play.
George has been around a long time. He'll be feeling very comfortable.
Oh, he looks 21.
He's got a nice check coming anyway.
Roland announces
call. Perfect. Oh, wow. Well, I mean, what did he... Why did he take so long with a pair of eights? He's got well over $1 million. That's very strange.
Well, now he's got the cards. It's a good call. Let's see if we go 3. Let's see if we get another player coming in this.
I mean...
He's got a full dose. There's one of De Wolf's eights. Can I just point that out? We've lost an eight. There's only one left.
I've worked out what he was doing. He's wondering whether to re-raise actually there to narrow the field down.
George McKeever goes heads up. Guaranteed fifth place. If he goes out now, let's see if the flop comes down. Oh, two spades there. It's not going to really do him any good, unfortunately. Nothing to talk about straight-wise yet. The tens, again, nothing is going to help there. It's a king or a queen for McKeever to stay in it. And we are in Ireland, but no more Irishmen will sit at this final table. Just 4 players left here in Dublin. And a true gentleman of Irish poker bows out. George McKeever leaves, and at least that time, the wolf was favourite going into the flop. George would be a happy man.
Not as happy as he would be to go up a couple of places.
I would like to be a fly on the wall when them two have a little drink together to see what the conversation's about, Willie and George. Sounds like a bad 80s sitcom, that, doesn't it? Willie and George. Okay, 30,000 for the big blind. Gavin Sims has played a perfect final table. He's not that well known. He doesn't need to become a name early on. I'll just play good cards. I'll slip into the background, and now I'm guaranteed fourth place. And who would bet against him in winning this?
You're right.
And that massive stack, usually at this stage, John, what we'd be saying is, okay, say Tavernier here, he's got the ace-king. It's all peeing in the wind, because... this is a massive stack that we see sitting in front of De Wolf. You know, okay, you know, Torsen's doing all right, but we'd say it was game over. But with the Wolf, you never know. And what he's been calling, you just don't know how many of those chips he's happy to throw away. So Torsen gets involved. Tavernier calls that. Means we get a nice healthy pot to start this one off. And for once, the Wolf's not involved. The Frenchman against the Swede. The Swede who hates losing. Interesting flop comes down. Torsen sitting in pole position as it stands at the moment with the flop, but is actually just slightly less favourite to win because of the flush draw that's came up, because of the inside straight draw that's come up for Tavernier. So really, John, what I'm saying is it's still a coin toss.
Well, Tavernier's favourite, obviously he's got two overcards and he's got the middle pin straight and the higher flush draw, but...
Hey, we've never had a straight flush, have we?
No, not yet.
Torsen's one card away. We haven't had a straight flush on the European Poker Tour. We're three series in.
I think Tavernier's going to move in here. Wow, that's incredible. That's incredible.
Wow.
That's very, very solid.
Cautious in the extreme. Doesn't want to put his chips in on a draw. John and I, we'd agree. We'd both chuck them all in.
Yeah, I would have done.
Torsen builds that stack. He's the main challenger.
William Torsen, I'm 23 years old and I'm from south of Sweden. I think I'm very good at playing the flop and I think I have pretty much respect from the other players. My father is a horse racing trainer, so I also bet a lot on horse racing. So I've been playing professional now for 5 years. I think that's what I'm gonna do for a few years at least, maybe my whole life.
23, eh?
What were you doing when you were 23?
I was head of Microsoft. Things spiraled down from there. 30 this month and a common poker commentator.
30, eh?
I wouldn't even ask you what you were doing when you were 23, John.
You know, I can't remember.
And put it this way, I know what you're doing at 45. I don't want to know what you're doing 23. Couldn't be any worse. Torsen then. King 8 suited. Remember, we're four-handed, so the card values go up. Gavin Sims knows this. He's liking his A7. And De Wolf is on the big blind. He just has to check to see the flop. So that's a full house for Gavin Sims. Of course he's checking it. Torsen will do the same. Oh no, Torsen's going to throw in.
William bets 45,000.
And Gavin would do well just to call.
I like the act. Oh dear.
Oh, I've seen this many Sundays a night.
Not one more penny is going to go into this pot. Not one more penny from William. No way. There's no way William will put one more penny in this pot. If he does, it's youth.
Oh, no. Well, there's the card that might bring it. Gavin's going to check it. Torsen bet when he'd nothing. He's now hit the king, but as you're right, John, he smelt the rat. The jack comes out, neither here nor there. This is where Gavin Sims is going to have to make a bet. Probably not an all-in one, unless he wants to make it look like a steal.
He's putting on a really good act here, or a really, really bad act. William should see right through this. He should see right through it. All respect to Gavin, he's played a good game, but really, this is kind of an open poker hand.
Well, there's a lot of players who reach their first EPT final table and look out of their depth. Gavin Sims has looked like he's in the shallow end. He's played a blinder. This is his hand, but you can't see William calling.
No, he can't call. He mustn't call. If he calls, it isn't good. Think about it. What could he be calling with on the flop? There's no straight. There's no flush. William knows this. He can't possibly call him. He might dwell up a bit, try and get a bit of a read on him because he knows he's got a massive hand. That's the only thing. The only reason he could possibly be waiting is to try to get a read on, because he knows he's got a massive hand.
Gavin Sims, the face of a young Danny DeVito, and he takes that hand down with a full house and probably got as much out of it as he was going to get out of it, John.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, the stage is set. Four players left. A massive lead for Rowan De Wolf then, over 2 million chips. A double up by Torsen puts him in it. A double up by Sims, he's got a chance. Same for Tavernier. Don't rule anyone out the way De Wolf's playing at the moment. Four players left. Four rich men have went out. 40,000 for the big blind now. You look at a stack like, you know, over 3,500 for Tavernier. It's going to cost him a third of his stack just to play four or five hands here.
Yeah. So we're going to see every four hands. Yeah,
every four. We're going to see. So we're going to see action.
Of course. Every four hands they're putting in 76. Anything.
Put it this way, he's going to get a chance to double up.
The one thing is, I think he'll move in, yeah.
Roland de Wolf is in first position with King 6, even four-handed. That raises from nowhere. It's from nowhere, John.
You really don't like his.
I don't like him. No, I do. You know, fair play to him. He'd wipe me out. But I'm just calling it as I see it, whether right or wrong, you know.
Looks like William might have a hand. William's thinking. He might have.
He's thinking the Wolf don't have any.
Well, he's checking behind him. He's trying to work out.
Ready to go?
He's trying to work out what's going on here. He must have a pair or ace queen minimum.
I tell you what, we've seen Thorsen lose a couple of bad beats. One at this final table, a couple in yesterday's play. He holds the biggest grudges. I love that about him. He's still angry from earlier today when de Wolf got lucky in the river.
Oh yeah, he doesn't like it. Doesn't like it.
I've never seen anyone react to bad beats like Thorsen. He was evil stirs. I love it.
He can't call here. I mean, even if he's got over 2 million in chips, I just don't see how he can call over 200,000. Oh.
And call.
Wow.
David Olin being called by Roland. David said it's ace, seven of clubs.
That's.
And Roland said it's king, so you make a paddle.
Weird.
Incisive commentary. Well, you know what? I'm just going to keep my mouth shut here. You can watch this hand unfold. You can make your mind up for yourself.
Three to hit as well now.
Well, thank the good Lord. Thank the good Lord.
No, that's not good news for Gavin. The thing is, here is that Gavin and David Tavernier. Kind of similar in chips, but there's a big difference. Well, you know, the difference between fourth and third, nearly 50,000.
It's all about the money, and David doubles up.
David Tavernier, 50 ans, de Paris. Donc je joue depuis très jeune, depuis l'âge de 18-19 ans. J'ai joué les parties libres avec des amis et tout, et j'aime beaucoup les tournois. Parce que pour une mise minimum, on peut gagner beaucoup et surtout on peut jouer longtemps et sans perdre trop d'argent. Alors mon style de joueur de poker, c'est plutôt basé sur l'attaque et l'opportuniste, d'être très opportuniste par rapport à sentir des faiblesses chez les joueurs et bluffer beaucoup de coups.
Well, I think you're being outbluffed here, David.
Bluffer beaucoup de coups, I like that. I use that a lot in Paris next time I go there.
Not going to work in Barcelona. Jack 7 suited, we're four-handed. Gavin might like that, on the button.
120. Gavin raising to 120,000.
Look at that, he hasn't even got the chips in yet, but I think Roland might have something here. His hands were on the chips before. Well, he's pocket sixes, yes, okay. We'll give him this one, Roland.
Well, Gavin's pretty much committed here. I think he's got to call.
And he's got two over cards. And he's suited. And actually, look at those odds. It's a coin toss.
Yeah, absolutely. If he could see Roland's cards, he'd call like a shot. I think he must know he's got to. I don't know how much he's got left. I'm just looking, trying to see. He's got 250 left.
He's also worked out. He's looked at the other stacks in front of him, and he knows he'd be crippled if he doesn't call. Look, he's resigned to calling.
It's bad, but I call.
He's got to call. Now he really likes it now. He's really pleased he's called.
We're talking about mistakes that players have made. Gavin Sims has not made a mistake.
No.
Re-raising in pocket sixes. Sicky.
Well, there you go. Someone's just called Roland de Wolf the chip leader sick, which isn't... Oh, there you go. Well, he's played a blinder, it has to be said, but the sixes came out. The Wolves got the three sixes. And I'm afraid that sign of the devil means that Gavin Sims is about to be buried. The seven comes out at this stage. Again, that's absolutely no good. He's drawn dead at the moment. Another seven won't help him. That'll be a full house for Roland de Wolf. We now know three players who may win the EPT title in Dublin. But Gavin Sims has announced himself on the international poker scene in a big, big way. Played very well. And Dr. Logic will be back. The Wolf takes that hand down. He's now firm favourite to become EPT champion in Dublin. Let's face it, all he needs is two cards to bet any hand. Back after the break. It's night time in Dublin. And it's D-Day inside the Regency Hotel. Well, I have to say, I don't... No, he's not in a great position to win this, but William Torson, for me, has been a revelation in Dublin. I think he's been a wonderful player. I think he's what the EPT is all about, a 23-year-old coming through. There's definitely been a shift in the poker world in EPT. They're getting younger every programme. And it's really helped the sport advance in Europe, and William Torson's a shining example of that. David Tavernier qualified online, and he's reached the final table. Another qualifier, he's done that. They went all the way, haven't they, the online qualifiers? We'd give them the big checks.
William, I agree with you, Colin. I think William Thorson is the player that's most impressed me at this, you know, at the final table and throughout the tournament.
Well, that flop impresses him because he's just hit a straight on the flop. Let's see what he can get out of this. Tavernier's the one that comes out betting because he's got two pair as it sits at the moment. It's a dream hand for William Thorson. This could be exactly what he needs to get back into this tournament.
Too comfortable calling there.
Just eights and queens. Just eights and queens. Wow, Tavernier's went all in. We could be losing him. Thorson calls it. He's got the straight. Just queens and eights are a problem here. Wonderful stuff for William Thorson. Oh, no, it's another absolute stinker.
Oh.
Well,
he's just having no luck. He just has no luck. Unbelievable.
You know the Monty Python sketch with a wet fish and the guys just get hit in the face with a wet fish? William Thorson must feel like this at the final table. He's lost close to a million chips on bad beats today.
No, it's so unlucky. It's incredibly unlucky.
But I tell you what, and I hope I'm not overstepping my mark, if he had to lose to a bad beat, I'm glad they've went into the hand of Tavernier.
It's poker, you have two pair, what can you do? Nothing to do, you have to play.
He was completely cold there. William accepts the fact that this hand played itself and he got incredibly unlucky.
And it has to be said, Tavernier made absolutely the right call.
Yeah, of course.
Absolutely the right call with a two pair.
Absolutely the right
absolutely.
Call.
Absolutely. Oh dear. Without a doubt, one of the strangest days of poker in the history of the EPT. I don't think I've seen a game of poker like this, John, since we had that private transvestites-only poker tournament in London. Do you remember that night? That was crazy.
I'd rather you didn't talk about it. Thanks. Not on the air.
Tavernier, seven figures of chips in front of him now, over a million, in a very strong position. We're three-handed. Getting hit with a king-nine is a very good place to be.
The turnaround here is incredible. I feel so sorry for William Thorson. I really do. He's played such a great game. Anyway, I'm not going to go on about it.
Well, this could be his comeback moment because he's got the ace-10. He's favourite over Tavernier. He'll like that odds if it's heads up.
Yeah, but Roland's got a hand here.
But Roland's thrown his hat into the ring with the pocket sevens.
Yeah, and William's committed. He's going to have to call here. He's got to call.
Good fold by Tavernier. Thorson's called all in. It's just 90,000. He has to do it, and he's going to get called. And we're going to go for a coin toss here. We could be heads up. England against France will be the last two players unless Thorson can finally see something come good for him at this final table, which he hasn't in such a long time. It doesn't help him. The sevens stand tall. The queen comes out. That does help. That puts him... At least that means he can hit a 10, he can hit an ace, and he can hit a king. A king will give him a straight. Thorson one card from going out. It's not the card he wanted. William Thorson, who's impressed universally here. The 23-year-old has landed, along with himself and Sims. It's been a great tournament for new blood. He goes out in third place. he goes home with €184,000.
Ben, again, please.
And quite a few tales of bad beats to tell around the dinner table or the pub table or wherever he ends up tonight.
It's horrible when you play your best game and you get beaten.
Straight onto the text. Well, we know either De Wolf or Tavernier will be EPT champion. De Wolf is the clear chip leader. One double up from Tavernier, though. And it'll be almost even Stevens. Loads to play for. Well, John, you think about where Tavernier's came from. An online qualifier, clicking away on the mouse of his computer. Oh, I'll just play this satellite. And here he is now going heads up. And even though he's only got one chip for every two that De Wolf has, he's got a real fighter's chance.
Oh, well, he has. He's not just an online player, Tavernier. I mean, he's been around a while. I recognise him from the circuit in Paris. It's interesting. I think obviously the favourite has to be De Wolf at the moment, but anything can happen, as you quite rightly said. You know, if Tavernier just makes a few doubles up and wins a few chips, it can change in the blink of an eye.
Okay, well listen, it's England against France, always tasty. Well, Roland De Wolf has been playing cards since he was 12. He used to edit Inside Edge Poker magazine. He's been around the sport for forever and a day. And this could be that day that he makes his mark on the international scene in the best tournament in Europe. Well, as it stands at the moment, Roland De Wolf has over 2.5 million chips. David Tavernier, about 1.3 million. Let's see how this one works out. De Wolf's got the open-ended straight draw. Ha! Nothing for Tavernier, that's a straightforward bluff. And it's been called straight away by De Wolf.
See if he can fire again on the turn if nothing comes.
And nothing has.
Connie, he should have fired again there.
And he didn't. He checked it and the last card comes out. Lo and behold, De Wolf has a straight.
Indeed, he's got the nuts.
Please welcome Cilla Black to sing Surprise, Surprise.
Well,
I've never been more exhausted by doing a poker commentary in my life than I have tonight watching this final table. It's been one thing after another, as my mum would say.
It's very difficult. It's very difficult when somebody is hitting cards like this. It just makes the game look fixed. Which it isn't, of course.
Look at that face. If Tavernier had have followed through in De Wolf's favour, if Tavernier had followed through when the jack came down, the hand would be over.
Tavernier's got to do this act here, this sort of dwell-up, because he's got to try to make it look as though he had a hand when he bet. He can't follow through now.
Yeah. He can't let De Wolf know that he had nothing in the first place.
Exactly.
Well, I can't see this lasting long. I really can't. Between De Wolf throwing in on whatever he has in his hand and Tavernier now needing the chips.
No, it's true. You know, if Roland were to win this event, he would become the first player ever to have won a WPT, an EPT and a WPT event.
Wow. A winner on the World Poker Tour and the European Poker Tour. It's never happened before. A little bit of history.
Yep.
Possibly.
No worries.
Right, De Wolf's got 9-5. Tavernier, 6-4 suited. So look at the flop. Doesn't help anyone. Let's see how it bets. That's what's going to decide this, as it does with many heads-up hands. Again, not going to help anyone. He who bets wins.
Yeah, Roland will try to represent the ace now, having raised pre-flop.
And he pushes that in with absolutely nothing. It's a good bet. It's what he should have done. He's already represented the ace.
Oh, Tavernier's moving in here. This would be a great move. Oh.
Re-raised enough.
Brilliant move.
To get De Wolf off the hand. Now, De Wolf didn't take that time to think it out. He didn't take that time to say, you know, David, you're not, you know, I wasn't bluffing. I just think you've a better hand. He just went right up. Move on.
He showed him the bluff there, though, too. He just showed him the bluff. He shouldn't have done that, I don't think, because up until now, he's been playing a very solid game.
Yeah.
Why show a player a bluff now? really when you need every single tool in your arsenal. Yeah.
Roland's got lucky, but he's a good player. On the whole, he's won tournaments, he's a good player. He knows poker inside out, just today for some reason. And the second half of yesterday.
Yeah, no, he's got very good form, Roland. He's very aggressive. And when you get hands, you get pace.
Well, we're going to see a flop come down here, John. Sorry to interrupt you. I don't like to do that. I'm the politest commentator in the business. It's fives. Oh, it's trip fives for DeWolf. Queen high for Tavernier. This could be a definitive hand. It already is. 70,000 from Roland. Tavernier could do serious damage to his stack here.
Well, Roland's come out betting his trips again. And see, I don't know, there's a great possibility here that Tavernier may try to represent the ace again, make it on the assumption that because he showed the bluff last time, this time Roland will believe him.
Oh, he's raised.
There he does. It's exactly, and Roland's going to love this. Now he's going to put the act on. How can I get these chips? How can I get all this guy's chips?
David Tavernier may have just committed poker suicide. At the very least, he's going to cripple himself here.
Well, Roland's just going to call this.
Yes.
Okay, for starters.
Just call.
He's going to just call. He's not afraid of anything because he's, you know, he's got so many chips anyway.
Is he?
But also, heads up. Heads up a set is a huge hand.
Yeah, he is just going to call.
Okay, so let's see if anything significant comes on the river.
We already know the hand is going to DeWolf.
Nothing.
We already knew that. Nothing could help.
Now, if Roland checks here, Colin, I think that Tavernier may move in.
Yeah, he might push all in.
But if he bets, the thing is, he may bet and induce a bluff anyway.
He might want to make it look like he's pushing these fives, the fable of the fives. DeWolf's already bet the fives straight out. He said, look, I've hit my trips. And if Tavernier doesn't believe him, maybe a bet is the way forward here.
He'd have to move all in, though, to get him off the hand. Oh, he has done. He's moved all in.
And he's moved all in over the top.
He thinks that Roland's bluffing. Yeah, that's what's happened.
Well, the writing is on the wall. It's all done. Roland DeWolf is champion in Ireland here in the third series at EPT. That's a seat at Monte Carlo for free. That's over €500,000. And that is the title of an EPT champion. It's as big as it comes in the sport. And one way or the other, he's got there. God knows why. Don't ask me to explain, but he's got there. John, he's your champion, no matter what we say. And he's going to be chatting now with Natalie.
So, Roland, wow, you've done it. Fantastic. Now, you obviously went in as chip leader, pretty confident throughout. When do you think you had it in the bag?
When he showed the last hand.
Oh, come on.
No, right up to then, it was never very sure that I was going to win. But, you know, I've just had, from the very start of the tournament, I've been so lucky. Every time I've been behind, I've come out on top. And every time I was in front, I held up. I've just, like, been so blessed the whole week. You know, I've run so well that, like, you know, things sort of were going with me, and I won key coin flips, and things just have gone my way the whole tournament. So, you know, it's been a great great achievement for me, because there's so many great players in the tournament, and so many players, good players, anyone can win, and I've just had a really lucky run, which is what you need.
Well, I think they say you make your own luck in life, and I think he deserves a huge round of applause, everyone. Roland DeWolf.
DeWolf's our winner here on the EPT. He's won a WPT before, and he played fantastic in that. Rode his luck a bit today, but he's a good player. Roland DeWolf takes over €500,000 away with him. Tavernier, fantastic. And Torsen and Sims have really announced themselves in the EPT. Just one Irishman in the top eight, but only one name matters every time, and that's the winning name. That of Roland DeWolf. He's the man who gets the plaudits. He's the man who gets the applause. He's the man who gets top billing. He's the man who gets the money. A seat in Monte Carlo and that EPT champion title. Thank you very much to John Duffy for joining me here in Dublin. And we'll be back with more in the EPT very soon. All take care and be lucky. Ninja!